up, guys? And here we go. This is the antenna, multi-band antenna shootout between two models that I've been rocking the last few years and a few couple of weeks. This one is the newest purchase here. This one is a quad band antenna, meaning I could do four bands on this antenna. Low band VHF or AM, actually, from 30 megahertz to 50 megahertz with a catch. There's always a catch. I could do VHF, so we're talking about the ham bands on 144 megahertz around there to federal frequencies up in the 170s. It could do UHF, ultra high frequencies, from 3 something to 470 around there. And then it could also go up to 700, 800, and I think 900 megahertz too, if I remember right. So those are the four bands that this could cover on one antenna. And then the competitor is this sable round looking antenna here that I've been using for quite a while. I want to say 3 years, 2 or 3 years. It's got some battle scars. It's a tri-band antenna though. It's not wideband, or quad band rather. Okay, it actually goes to 136 to 174. On the UHF side, it goes from 380 to 520. And on the upper super high frequencies, 698 to 960 megahertz. So in a vehicle configuration, both of these antennas will definitely cover the frequency of concern that you may have, especially if you're running a scanner. And for those of you that have a scanner in your vehicle, whether it be a handheld or one that's permanently mounted in your vehicle, these are two good viable options to use for that, and it will receive very well. Typically, and sometimes on vehicles, they will give you a long whip for it, and this one here is for VHF, and sometimes they will give you this to cover everything from low band up to upper 800 megahertz, 900 megahertz or so. But it's only tuned for VHF really, so you're going to receive really, really good on the VHF frequency, 144 to 170 around there, actually smaller than that. But it will be mediocre or poor on all the rest of the frequencies. Unlike these here, where you have, like in this model, it's got different traps and components here within the black plastic thing there. And all these just separate the four bands that it needs to operate on. So you would equally receive somewhat better than this antenna, including this one here. This one will do three bands, so they would actually serve really well as a multi-band antenna. There's nothing more efficient than the single band design, like this quarter wavelength VHF antenna, so you'll get the most performance out of something like this. And there's some caveat to that. If you're going from car to car, then a 5/8 wavelength antenna, which will be a little bit longer than this and have a loading coil like that, will get you double the power, double the efficiency shooting horizontally. I covered that in another video a long time ago, and you could look that up yourself. But basically, and I know I got some comments in the past saying that these antennas here will equally receive and transmit poorly on everything, even though it's tuned for it and everything. Yeah, that's true to some certain extent, but when we're treating this like a multi-tool, this is the Leatherman of antenna, vehicle antenna systems. This is another Leatherman for vehicle communications. It's specified to handle the three bands in this case, four bands with this case, but not very efficiently as opposed to a single tool or single antenna band antenna. So this will be like your screwdriver, you know, and it'll do really well as a screwdriver, but then the screwdriver on this one will not be as good as a single screwdriver on this, meaning the multi-tool screwdriver is not as efficient as a single purpose-built screwdriver, single-tool screwdriver. That's kind of like the correlation that I'm trying to make here. There's a lot of compromises to this design here and this design here compared to this, but what you get back in capabilities, it sometimes will be, you know, better than having the single band antenna there, depending on your application. You see, my application is I maintain a lot of these systems out there. I don't want a vehicle with a porcupine top full of antennas like a lot of these hams and stuff like that. I want to consolidate, streamline, and compact everything. And, you know, it's sort of a pet project of mine as well. So for my applications of just listening out there and seldomly transmitting out there, this configuration here where I'm combining all the radios that I have in the vehicle, and we're talking about three or four of them into a single antenna, will be beneficial to my specific application. Your mileage may vary. Perhaps you do want a separate, you know, antenna to work a specific band for the most efficiency, but you know, with your requirements and what you want to accomplish out there, it may not be technically advisable to do that. So you have to compromise with something like this, not in every case. This is, you know, specifically, I'm only dealing with what I'm going through with my setup. This is not show and tell for, you know, YouTube land for views or nothing like that. This is what I'm actually doing for myself in my application as somebody who maintains systems out there and also as a prepper. You know, it all interrelates with each other, and that's how I'm treating this. This is, you know, stuff I want to do for myself, and I'm taking you guys along with the ride and showing my method of madness and see if you guys will, you know, either listen or not. It's up to you. So I think I'm blabbing a little bit too much here, and let's get to the equipment here. Like I said, this one right here is a quad band antenna. It's going to do everything that I need on one antenna. I could put four radios onto this antenna here. And I have, and I've been running it like that for a good 2 or 3 weeks, I think. And so far, so good. This one here is an Austin antenna, and I got it from rfwiz.com. No affiliation with the website. Pretty much I made the research on it and found out where they, you know, make this or sell this, and I just, you know, blind faith purchased it and see what's going to happen. Cost me $109. So far so good, but I do have some concerns. This guy right here is a wide spectrum multi-band antenna made by PCTEL, and now you could pretty much get this everywhere for about $100. I've seen it from $85 to $100 now. I think I bought this for like maybe $165 brand new a few years ago when it was first hot on the market. And the part number to this is PCTWSLMR, and it's a tri-band antenna. And there's others out there. I just chose this one because it covers a little bit of the 700 megahertz frequency range, which I want to monitor as well. So instead of going by the numbers of what the manufacturer is telling us what this thing does, let's actually measure what these guys do on the test equipment, which I've already done, and I got the snapshot of this. So we're going to go into low band VHF, or just low band frequencies. We're going from 30 megahertz to 50 megahertz on the Austin Spectra antenna here. This guy does not do low band antennas. In reality, there's really not much of a market for combining low band VHF frequencies with the higher frequencies like VHF and UHF. So there's more of the tri-band configuration than there is the quad band, but luckily this one company does do it. I take that back. There's a shitload of these antennas in the ham band frequencies, but I don't deal with the ham bands much. This is pretty much public safety, fire, cops and ambulances and services like that, not the ham band itself, though it is capable of doing ham bands. But I digress. So we're going to look at the low band VHF side, which is 30 megahertz to 50 megahertz. And as a comparison, since this guy cannot do it, we're going to use this low band wide band antenna. So this guy here covers from, I think, 39 megahertz up to 50 megahertz. This guy right here. So if we look at it on the screen here, the green line, which is down this way, is the single band antenna, and the white line here is the Austin Spectra antenna on low band. It doesn't have a wide bandwidth for that frequency range. It's like 2 megahertz wide, where the wide band VHF low band antenna is actually designed for a wider sort of spread of frequency. So like I said, I think it's going from 40 megahertz up to around 50 megahertz there, and this is the -10 dB return loss line here. That's pretty much the cutoff point between a good working antenna and a bad one, I would say. The Austin antenna, Spectra antenna, is not doing so hot on that particular band. You're barely making it at a -9.3 dBm return loss. It's barely passing, if not. I forget what the SWR ratio is at. You could look that up yourself, but it's not very good compared to this guy right here, where is dipping down into the -30, around the -30 range right here. So here at 12, it's doing pretty good here. So this is a good example of a single band purpose built antenna compared to like a wide band sort of compromise, so you can get everything, your Leatherman against a screwdriver. So, but for my purposes, I could hear and tune into the specific frequency that I'm concerned with in my area just okay with this level here. I'm perfectly fine with this. The fade margins between the repeaters up on the mountain down to where I may be receiving this signal there would definitely overcome whatever discrepancy that the antenna might have, and I could hear them just fine. And I could transmit just fine from those locations, except it may be in you know, some of the deeper mountainous area in the background there. But usually I'm never on this frequency. I just monitor and do my thing, but it barely passes specifications, and I'm fine with that. That's my call, and that's my operating sort of parameters for this. And compared, I'd much rather have a smaller 30-inch antenna than hauling a 40 or 50-inch antenna, you know, going through parking lots and stuff like that, or just standing out, you know, in general. So that is my compromise that I'm taking with this particular equipment here.